We're on the third set of Apple Teardowns here at iFixit HQ, and this time around we have the AirPods 4 and the new USB-C AirPods Max on our Teardown table. AirPods have historically been a nightmare to take apart, consistently earning 0 out of 10 on our repairability scale. But their bigger and more expensive sibling, the AirPods Max, are bordering on repairable, with the first version earning a 6 out of 10 thanks to a relatively easy disassembly process. How much has changed since the last time we've seen AirPods on our Teardown table? Let's crack right in and take a look. Now before we get started, let's take a look at the AirPods 4 under the revealing rays of Lumafield's Neptune scanner. With the AirPods 4 tucked into their charging case, you can see just how densely packed they are with tech wizardry. Except for the large rectangular mass of the case's battery, every nook and cranny of the buds are crammed to the gills with tiny boards and ICs. Hopefully, we'll be able to get a look at some of those without too much destruction. I'm taking a page out of Phone Repair Guru's book and attempting a non-destructive battery removal. It should be noted, the moment this jig comes out is the moment this thing becomes unrepairable for the average consumer, regardless of whether the battery can be successfully replaced. This is a highly specific and specialized tool. For now though, let's humor the notoriously unrepairable AirPods and see how far we can get. With a reflow station and a ton of patience, I'm heating the pods to around 110 degrees C, carefully moving every few seconds to avoid applying too much heat to one spot. Eventually, I get the gap I need to pry the stem of the buds away from the driver assembly. I can immediately see the lithium-ion battery, a consumable component that will eventually need to be replaced. What you're seeing here is what goes on in independent repair shops that deal with AirPod battery replacements. Apple stores and Apple authorized repair shops don't do this. They'll shred the pods to separate the components and the battery, but most of the materials and the energy required to make them gets wasted. On these AirPods 4, we can see two solder points securing the battery to very delicate ribbon cable connections. I'm not stopping here though, let's dig a little bit further to see what's sitting deep inside the stack of components. For that, I need the reflow station, set to 100 degrees C this time, to help melt the adhesive that's pretty much all over these components. There are functional reasons for using this type of glue, securing the driver, reducing unwanted vibrations, and even protecting against moisture and dust ingress. Still, the IP54 rating that gives these buds a good measure of splash resistance is not a guarantee of waterproofing, meaning any damage to the buds is out of warranty and any repair to the circuitry is near impossible due to its construction. After about 10 minutes of digging, I finally managed to get the driver away, revealing the in-ear microphone, which in the ANC version is used both for spatial audio and noise cancellation. The non-ANC version has the exact same microphone, but it's only used for spatial audio. Underneath the inner microphone is the optical sensor consisting of two LEDs and a receiver, together used to measure light absorption and reflection from the skin. These sensors are how the auto-pause feature of the earbuds work. With a bit more digging, I can release the rest of the inner ear circuitry, but I can already see that there's some damage to the flex cables. The inner ear mesh is first to come away, and soaking the rest of the components with alcohol helps me pull everything else out. Now it's time to turn my attention to the stem, starting with the lower microphone and terminal contacts. It's like Spider-Man put this thing together, the glue is refusing to let go. After removing the glue, I tried applying extra heat to get the interior of the buds to release to no avail. I ended up deforming the plastic and eventually cutting through the stem to release the electronics hiding inside. It's unfortunate that the outer shell and the AirPods have such a low melting point. It makes removing the adhesive inside a real challenge. With the inner components out, I'm going to use my FixHub Power Series portable soldering station to remove the 1.23 milliwatt hour battery. This portable smart soldering iron can go from zero to ready to solder in about 5 seconds, and it's all powered with a 55 watt hour rechargeable battery that can keep you soldering for up to 8 hours without recharging. They're available to pre-order on our website today. Now let's take a closer look at the components we just removed. Much like the AirPods Pro 2, both versions of the AirPods 4 are capable of both 2.4 GHz and 5 GHz transmissions, which enables ultra-low latency audio when combined with devices like the Vision Pro. Both versions have the exact same system and package, or SIP, housing the brains. In fact, we won't be tearing down the AirPods 4 ANC because the only difference between the two earbuds appears to be a single outward-facing microphone, the ANC version having a bigger, beefier mic. We can clearly see how similar the two buds are with CTs provided by our Lumafield Neptune scanner. The buds are 99% identical, meaning that the difference between ANC and non-ANC models appears to be a $2 microphone. It's time to move on to the case. Heating the back of the case loosens the adhesive enough to pull the lid away along with the hinge. Now it's back to the usual heating and prying process that's proven to be so massively destructive with AirPods cases. Just for the record, Sony, Samsung, and of course Fairphone all figured out how to make their buds cases accessible for easy battery replacements. As far as these AirPods are concerned, gentle heat doesn't help. A sharp knife can't get between the seams, and honestly, I'm out of patience with this device at this point. A simple battery replacement shouldn't be this demanding. Blasting the case with 130 degrees C for a bit does more than just deform the plastic. The problem is, it's still not enough to get into the device. There's far too much prying with metal tools for my liking, especially after my bloodletting with the Apple Pencil Pro. The answer? Enough heat to make the case uncomfortable to hold. This just isn't fun anymore. In a surprising turn of events, it seems I've been prying at the plastic that holds the earbuds, a separate component from the rest of the case. The functional components that make everything tick are still inside. Wouldn't you know it, we need more heat. In the AirPods engineering team's defense, there's less glue in here than I found in the AirPods Pro 2, and the inner tray looks like it was designed to slide out. The spoiler is the glue. Had they just used clips, then the design for an easy disassembly was already there. I need to try for that battery, and I'm starting with the only screws in sight, the two T3 screws next to the USB-C port. Unfortunately, that does nothing, so I'm gonna have to take a more direct approach to removing the cover over the battery press connector. That does the trick, and while I'm here, I'm gonna pop the only other press connector on this PCB. It's time to remove the 1.3 watt-hour battery pack. It's been an absolute ordeal to get this far, and I've destroyed the entire device to do it. Also worth noting, no stretch release adhesive and no electrochemical battery removal process. We're keeping a close eye on how this tech develops in future. The last component to come out is the PCB. If we take a look at x-rays of the ANC version, we can again find the exact same PCB, but with a speaker inside the housing. This is another component that contributes to the extra $50 you'd pay for the ANC version. As far as I can tell, those are the only two differences. The AirPods Max are next on the teardown table. There's not been any reported changes other than the charge port, which drops the lightning port in favor of a USB-C port. That doesn't seem to be the end of the lightning connector in this device though. The headband is still essentially utilizing a mini lightning connector to connect the two ear cups. It's been a while since we opened up AirPods, so I forgot about the quarter turn to release the locking mechanism underneath. Those screws aren't the real challenge though, the adhesive running all the way around the edge is the real problem. Applying heat would definitely make this job easier, but I've got to be careful not to distort the speaker diaphragm. It mostly comes down to applying force through one of the screw holes and lifting enough of the plate up to get a pick in there. But once the pick is in, it's easy going. There's a fair bit of adhesive here, and it feels a little bit on the stretchy side. Disassembling the Lightning version didn't seem to present nearly as much adhesive. Compared to the first version of the AirPods Max, there's not much different here. Other than the obvious USB-C swap, the internals look near identical. There are some visible tweaks to the board housing the charge port, but otherwise nothing appears to have changed. So here we are again, another year and another AirPod teardown that totally disappoints on the repairability front. And it's a shame too, because Apple has made a functionally amazing piece of hardware that brings some real quality of life improvements, but at the expense of creating the device that's totally disposable. The AirPods Max, however, remain unchanged from the 2020 release model. We still don't have parts or manuals for these $500 headphones, and the entry process into the cups is awkward at best. With this in mind, the AirPods 4 and AirPods 4 with ANC receive a provisional score of 0 out of 10 on our repairability scale, and the AirPods Max USB-C version score remains unchanged at a provisional 6 out of 10.